Yeah, we are live. Welcome everyone to our first show in this new year, okay, with lots of hopes. 2021, we all expect this to be a great year. We expect to put past all the shadows of gloom in the last year, okay, and we have one of the greatest names of Indian art with us today. And on behalf of all of you, I welcome Sri Sudhir Padwardhan sir to Neat Talk Statistics show. Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you for accepting our invitation. And just to give you a brief profile, most of you know that, but to do our duty, our honors. Sri Sudhir Padwardhan is born in 1949 in Pune. He graduated in medicine from the Armed Forces Medical College, Pune, in 1972, and has been practicing as a radiologist. And different shades of Mumbai, especially the life of common man stuck in the labyrinth of urban clusters, can be widely seen in his works. One of the most acclaimed painters in India today, he has exhibited works in various parts of the world, including France, Germany, UK, USA, and Switzerland. In 2019, NGMA conducted a major and well-received retrospective show of Sudhir sir's works. Actually, many people, including many of the artists and art enthusiasts from this group also, did visit NGMA to participate in that retrospective show that attracted huge crowds, in fact. His paintings are included in many public and private collections in India and abroad, including many major museums. His works have been a theme of many books, movies, and plays. Some of them include The Complicit Observer and The Crafting of Reality, Sudhir Padwardhan's drawings by Ajit Boskote, and a film, Sacha, by Anjali Montero and K.P. Jaishankar, and a play, Chitra Goshti, by Mumbai Theatre Group, Avishkar, directed by Sushma Deshpande, and many more. Sudhir sir curated an exhibition of Indian contemporary art named Expanding Horizons, which traveled around Maharashtra, including many villages. And we believe, like Niracharthu being an art initiative from a small village in Kerala, strikes a chord with Sudhir sir's mission and passion of proliferation of art among common man. And we are honored today to have him as guest for our first program in this year. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Satish, and thank you everyone for being here. I'll start my screen sharing.
Sir, one second, I will just give you permission.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so what I've decided to do today in sharing my work is to focus on two kind of common subjects or areas in which I have in my work can be seen. These two polarities, like between inside and outside. So a lot of my work is to do with the outside, with the city, street scenes, the world outside. And also my work has to do with the interiors, with the home, with the studio. So these are the two main themes that I have decided to focus on. In other words, it is like Rabindranath Tagore's phrase, home and the world. So between these two themes, I will divide my works and show you. I am again not going to go through a chronological order from the beginning as such, because I have been painting since 1970, so that is a long time back, and I am want to focus more on the recent work, so last 15 years or so, on the last 15, work from the last 15 years I'll focus on, and we'll see how it goes from there on. I'm also going to show you a lot of details. The reason being that in this format, one sees the painting on a small size, and most of my works are fairly large. And one can see the overall structure of the work, but one may not be able to make out the many details that are inside in that work. So I'm going to show you a lot of details. So there are the paintings and the details will be shown one after the other. So I'll start with paintings of the city, which is the outside, essentially, which has been my common theme for many years now. Ever since I came to Bombay in 73, the city has been a subject matter for me. This is a recent painting. It's called A Normal Day. And it represents something of, it is sort of celebration, you might say, of celebration of just the everyday. What you see every day, you go out in the morning, you see people going to work, you see buses and trains and all that. So this is a kind of, it is not making any other statement rather than a kind of celebration, you might say. Celebration not in the sense of, but just a record of a normal happenings in the city. So a couple of details of this where you see. I'm showing details so that we can see the way in which things are painted. Rather than just focusing on the subject matter, we can see the way in which the paint is applied, the way in which figures are drawn and things like that, which after all for painters is the more important aspect of the painting. So here you see a number of people. So on the left side, people are going to the left mostly. Maybe someone's waiting at a tea shop for a morning cup of tea. And on the other side, again, you see people going to the right, going towards the railway station, probably young student. And within that, there is what you might call a small incident or an event, you might say, as someone called it, of that woman who's selling something there and her small child and the lamb. So this is just a record of something one could have seen, but it gives another dimension. We will see the whole painting again. Sorry. So this gives a kind of wholeness to the kind of things that you encounter daily while walking through the city. The next painting is called Bailen Saga. It is an older painting from 207. Here again, there are many things happening, like similar to the other painting. There are people coming, people going, but it is divided in a somewhat different way. There it was a horizontal painting divided only in a kind of two halves on the left side and right side. This is a diptych, so it is a larger painting. Most of my works are maybe 6 feet by 4 feet. This is double that size being a diptych. And the period from 90 to recently, 3 years back, were mainly in acrylic. Before that, I was painting in oils. These are all acrylic paintings. But again, the last one that you saw, it was oil, because I've started reusing oil from the last 3-4 years. So this is called Bailen Saga. Here again, you see multiple happenings in the city. You see people going and coming. That is one thing in the lower part. In the upper part on one side, you see this, an old man with talking to a lady, or probably asking the lady to hand the baby to him. The baby doesn't seem to be very interested. So this is a kind of normal happening that you might encounter in a city. This is another in the middle part of the diptych, upper part, where you see a boy playing maybe and a woman with a cat. But on the left side, you see something that is a little more disturbing. So here you see a man who has fallen down. Some people either trying to help him up, or maybe they're the ones who have beaten him up or, you know, caused some harm to him. So this aspect of underlying violence that one encounters in city life is an aspect that I've always wanted to portray. And in this painting, you see that aspect portrayed as one of the things. It's called Bi-Lane Saga because in different lanes in the city, different things are happening. And this is one incidence in that. And to see the whole painting again, you'll observe that that has a peculiar structure. It's divided into, I would say, like maybe four or five parts. Up and down, it is divided between upper and lower part. And the upper part is also divided into three parts. So this is something like I call it a structure that is similar to an altarpiece in a church, except that in the center of an altarpiece, you normally would encounter the image of Christ or a crucifixion or something. Well, here that element is empty, more or less, in the sense there is no savior in this picture, and life is just going on as it is without any sign of, except that you see that scaffolding, which might be a reference to a cross or something. So this is a kind of structure that I've used, multiple perspectives, multiple things coming together. So this was Bi-Lane Saga. This is another recent painting called Nagrik. This was in fact the most recent painting in the retrospective. So here, it's a different kind of structure. It's a different kind of painting. You see, first thing you see is these four large figures. They're not standing on ground as such. They're floating almost. And what they're floating on is an image of a kind of cubistic reconstruction of multiple buildings, interiors, as well as exteriors of a city. So it is obviously a cityscape. And against that, these people, four people you see standing. I'll show you details of these. So here you see, it's called Nagrik for a certain reason. When I was doing this, all this question of the CAA and these things were coming up, and especially in Assam and things like that, there were a lot of injustice happening. A lot of people who were rightfully citizens of the country were denied their citizenship. And I thought that in the city, it is happening so often that people who have been living in the city for long, officially they may have their ration card, they might have whatever, but there is no sense of belonging. And that was brought forcefully forward during the pandemic now, when millions of thousands of migrant workers had to just leave. So the city was not hospitable to them in a crisis. They had to leave. So these people who work in the city, work for the city, ultimately are floating citizens in the sense they have no particular place to belong to. But within that, I have shown small areas where you see interiors of houses where certain incidences are shown. A woman tending to an old sick person, maybe someone studying while an older woman watches him. So these are all integrated into that image of a city where multiple things are going on. A carpenter may be working. This is a somewhat stranger figure in the last one on the right. And my idea was that it struck me that the idea of someone who is looking back on this with a certain kind of detachment. So he sees all this going on. He sees people, he sees injustice, he sees poverty, he sees hard work and the city as a complex thing. But he also can detach himself from this and see this as just part of the flow of life. So in that sense, this is a slightly different figure among those four. So this is the whole painting again, where you see multiple aspects of the city, insides and outsides, by lanes, and a port with a ship on the right. So all these elements called Nagrik, which refers to Nagar, Nagar as the city, and Nagriks, people who are rightfully part of the city, but somehow, you know, that sense of belonging is absent. The next painting that I'm showing is called Mumbai Proverbs. Now, this is the largest painting that I've actually done. It was a commission. It is a painting in 7 panels. It is 7.5 feet tall and 28 feet wide. So it's called Mumbai Proverbs. The commission, the brief was only that they wanted a painting on Mumbai. So I started thinking what I could do with this. And I came up with the idea that what I needed was a movement across the space was such that it was a very wide space. So I needed something that moved from left to right, right to left. So then the idea of something like a Japanese screen came to me, you know, where there is an accordion kind of movement between the panels. So coming forward, backward. So that was the idea why I chose the format of 7 panels. I will show you many details of this painting. First, I'm showing you the panels. So these are the first 3 panels. So how to think of the narrative in such a work. So my first idea was that I will try to weave a loosely historical narrative of the city. So it is like about the city as it began, but as it is experienced today. So parts of the city which belong to an earlier age and moving towards the city as it is now. So my experience of the city over 45 years or so, and how I structure that as a historical, that was one kind of way of looking at it. The other way was to also be able to link it rhythmically, as if I was traveling in a suburban train, maybe from VT to Thana or VT to Borivali or something like that. And along the way, as the city unfolds. So there is also that structure of moving from South Bombay to the suburbs. So these two structures somehow intervene. So this is the first 3, where on the left you see the fort area of Bombay, colonial Bombay. Then you see the mill area, the mill area, Paral Lal Bagh, that area. And then you move to the suburbs with the tenements and jhopadpattis and all that. This is panel 3, 4, and 5. I'm repeating panel 3, 4, and 5. 4 is the industrial part of the city. Initially, Bombay was a very industrial city. The mills, of course, cotton mills were the major industry, but there was a lot of industrial, chemical as well as engineering industry, a lot of automobile industry. This is one of the surviving automobile factories in Bombay. So I was interested in including that because I have been painting workers and the whole earlier period when I was painting these people. So I wanted to include that aspect of the city. Also, I was very attracted to the paintings of Diego Rivera, where, for example, in Detroit, he has this absolutely marvelous painting in the Ford Foundation, for Ford factory. So that was one reference. And then in the last panel, you see the very modern, the last 20 years, the way in which cities have changed, all the industry has moved out, all the service industry is more or less taken up. Service industry is now the major thing, where you see malls and the middle class has grown. The middle class has grown. And these are the places they travel a lot by air, which is in the lower part of that panel. And this kind of mall where there is a kind of continuous sense of forced celebration going on. So again, that last fifth panel is repeated, and sixth and seventh panels, which show modern kind of industry, the information technology industry, big corporate offices, maybe call centers, all this. And again, a repeat of what does not go away in Bombay are the hutments. No matter what kind of planning they try, no matter what they do, these elements of the hutments will continue to haunt us. I'm going to show you more details of individual parts of this painting. So this is right and the left in the first panel on top, which shows the kind of East India Company fort, which is a fort is named after that, the fact that there was a fort there. So the kind of thing that they started trading at that time, and the colonial structures of Elphinstone College and various other colonial structures, also the RC Church and this beautiful stained glass that is there in the RC Church. So what they brought in education in the colonial period, they brought in many things, and they also took away many more things. So a representation of that. Then, as I said, the mill areas where the mills are now closed down and high-rise buildings are taking their place, and the life of workers, the traveling in the trains, all this traveling, and the suburban railway stations, and the suburbs where the sprawl of hutments, and within that, all the new development that is taking place. Both high-rise buildings are displacing these hutments, and also the kind of metro and things like that, the newer developments. So it's a very complex and very complicated kind of visually, when you move around Bombay, you see so many contradictions, so many aspects, and yet it's extremely rich visually and extremely complex. Again, in the same panel, you see that when you see the hutments from far, you see them as an anonymous kind of structure, just patterns of houses and tin roofs and things like that. But when you go closer, of course, there's a whole lifestyle, there's a whole life going on there. So there are kids playing, there's that woman with the mobile phone, and there's a whole lot of things happening within those. So people are living their whole lives. This is as a detail of the factory. It happens to be the Mahindra factory who actually commissioned the work, the automobile factory, and the mall. Where, as I said, there is a continuous sense of celebration, which is forced in a sense. I mean, they have to keep that sense of happiness and, you know, everything going, loud music, everything. And people seem to enjoy that. People go there to be part of something. This is people in Bombay know Mount Mary Church, an important landmark in Bandra, and the Sea Link in Bandra. And as I said, the newer kind of IT industry, also the call centers, the monotony of that life in a sense. There is a nice a relief sculpture by Alex Matthew, which has a similar image. And he calls it, they think they are in heaven, but they are in hell. So I like that title very much. So you are in an AC, big AC office, and you have that small cubicle, and you have your computer and all that. But you're leading a very monotonous and, in a sense, kind of mechanized life. This is part of that, where an aspect of Bombay that is expanding on all sides. It has already reclaimed the city to a large extent, and it is threatened by the city as well. By the sea, I mean, the city is threatened by the sea. And as I said, the sprawl of the Hutments, the road going zigzag among that, very modern kind of buildings. These are two imagined buildings that don't exist in Bombay. But I was thinking like some architect, like we already have Tum Traor and we have all that. But an architect like Kaltrava could build his famous rotating torso buildings here in Bombay. And the last part in the right lower corner of the seventh panel is this dystopian future, where we feel that all the unwanted people have always wanted to hide what is not pleasant. So there have been various ways in which the Hutments, people have tried to recast them, paint them, do whatever, but none of them has been successful. So ultimately, maybe it'll be that people are pushed down below the ground to live, which is like similar to some dystopian films, the future that is shown in that. So this is that large painting. The seven panels, Bombay Proverbs done in 2014. Now I'll show you some paintings which are to do with studio and home. So this is a painting called The Abstractionist. It was done in 2005. It was more or less the period when I moved more definitely to painting more interiors, more people inside homes. I used to do that even earlier, but from 2005 onwards, along with this group of paintings that I did of the studio, I started to do more and more paintings that are to do with the studio and home. Abstractionist is a painting about art, in the sense that in Bombay especially, and in the 70s, 80s, 90s, all through, abstraction was considered the superior kind of painting. So anyone who was a good artist was supposed to be like, he would automatically become an abstract painter. Any realistic painting was considered like at a lower level. And Palshikar, the dean in JJ School, at one point, is Shankar Palshikar, is a very good painter and a friend of the first generation, very close to Tayyab Mehta, Akbar Padamsi, Gaitonde, all these people. So he used to stay close to his house, and he used to come often to my studio, and he used to like my paintings. But he used to say that because your paintings are good, you will someday become an abstract artist. So I used to find that very funny, because I had never had any inclination towards becoming solely an abstract artist. But I wanted to say, and this painting was a kind of answer to that, that I wanted to say that these two are not separate. That realism and abstraction are not two completely different things. That when I see reality, I see abstract shapes also, and I see colors and things, and I see reality in that way. So this was painting, I'll show you one detail of it. So this is the detail where the buildings outside are reflected in the glass of the bookshelf. And it has become a kind of abstract pattern. And then there is this drawing, which is an abstract drawing. So that person sitting there is an abstract artist who's looking at his abstract drawing. And there is this a kind of very beautifully structured element outside his window, the buildings, and the reflection, which are also abstract. So this idea of abstraction being something different from realism is something that I wanted to reject in a sense. This is a smaller painting, of course, a self-portrait. 2016. I continue with the idea of the kind of things that an artist faces in the studio, the kind of problems, the kind of ideas, the kinds of questions. So just as that first painting that in the studio, as you know, you're facing the idea of what abstraction is and what realism is. Here, it's a self-portrait, and it's called self-portrait with brush and camera. So one stands in front of the mirror. It seems as if here it could be standing in front of a mirror, or actually he could be standing in front of the canvas that he is painting. Now, this is not clear what it is. It's supposed to be both. And he's painting probably himself, but he's also taking a photograph of himself. So the idea here that is being explored is between these different modalities of image making, different, like you're looking at reflections in mirrors, you're looking at paintings, and you're looking at photographs. Between these different modalities, where can you say is that this is true or this is real? Is there any point which you can say that this is the real thing? So the idea is that we live with multiple reproductions and around us. We live with multiple reflections around us in different modalities. And we try to make sense of what the real is through those. So all these are languages, different languages. Photography is a language, painting is a language, and also seeing in a sense. We learn how to see. So that is also a kind of language. So between this, you make your way in the world to try and understand what truth or what reality or what truth is. So that is a kind of question that an artist is facing in a studio. This is another recent painting, Erase, of 2017. So here again, it's a similar situation. The artist seems to be standing in front of something, either a mirror or a painting. Here it's more likely to be a painting because he seems to be rubbing out something from that. That is where we as spectators are standing, and he seems to be erasing something there. And you see the image of the studio behind him, the palette. A detail of this. So this image, many of you may recognize, comes from a painting by Velasquez, La Meninas painting, which is a very famous painting. And there is this image of a man standing in the doorway. I quote it just because I want to say that this painting, I just go back to the painting, this painting has somewhat, is facing up somewhat to those questions that Velasquez poses in that painting. The question is that you see Velasquez standing in front of a canvas. He's painting on that canvas and he's looking out. He's looking out probably at the subject, that is the king and the queen standing for the portrait. But when you look at the painting, it looks as if he's looking at us, at the spectator. So this confusion between the spectator and the artist's position is something that is very intriguing. And Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh has written a very beautiful article on that painting, on the painting by Velasquez, Las Meninas. So those thoughts were there in my mind. And then on the right side of the painting, you see this with Shanta, my wife, sitting. Reggie's painting, which we have, and another French painting, Padmakar. So all these elements between home and studio, the way in which if one studio is at home, the way in which these realities intermingle. So that was one of the themes of the painting. Another painting from the same period, it's called Home. Here again, I'm interested in, I took up this horizontal structure to be able to unfold the structure of a home, of the different rooms of a home. Even in the earlier painting, it is kind of, if you imagine that you make a cardboard model of a house, and then you open it out, then the kind of opening out of that will reveal the different spaces in that house. So similarly, in these paintings are structured where you move from one room, it's as if it's an invitation to actually enter into one room, then go into the passage or go turn right and turn to another space or go through another door. So it's an invitation to become part of this space. So this is a painting called Home with a few details of the man coming out of the bathroom, memories around him, old man, photographic memories around him, a woman in the other place. That small drawing that you see up there, you can't make out much here, but it's actually a drawing by Jyoti Basu. So this is Home. This is an older painting called Visitation. This is again of our home, but an earlier place where we stayed. And it's imagined, it's not a representation of a real incidence or a real thing, but it's an imagined incidence where suddenly some unexpected kind of, you probably dream of something that's, it might be nightmarish, it might be different, it might be something. So this visit by an image, there's a person sleeping there, there is a hand on a keyboard as if music is playing, it may be in his dream, it may be real, and there is a very real outside the window, a very real thing in the window. So it's probably not a nighttime painting, it's probably an afternoon painting. So this is the view from the window. Someone clearing up the kind of kachra that is there on the rooftop. This is the figure. The way it is painted has this element of somewhat tortured sense of the skin and things like that. So like a disturbed moment in his sleep, maybe. And this image, this strange image of a very dark and naked woman emerging, either from the bathroom or from another room. Another painting called Inner Room, 2016. This again is part of the same series that you saw. The Erase and Home were similar sized like this. It's about, I think, 8 feet by 4 feet or something like that. So here again, that same idea of opening up a home, opening up the structure of rooms and revealing different rooms, different spaces to you. So here you see, it's the same window actually that you saw in Visitation. So this is the more normal view from the window. Like there's breeze flowing, there are some houses, trees. So there's nothing scary or nothing like dark about this. And there's a woman standing there and looking out. She does seem somewhat tense, but on the other side, on the right side, is a more a darker view where it's night sky. There's a kind of burning red in the sky. It could be just the sunset or it could be a fire, whatever. It's a city, obviously, it's seeing out of the window. And a man is looking at what could be a television, so that the kind of glare that is there on his face is reflected from what he's seeing on the television, which could be news of riots, which could be news of any kind of natural disaster or of man-made disasters, that kind of thing. So that's kind of mood in that room. And there is a painting on the wall. It's a reproduction that we had in our home for a long time. It's an Emil Nold, the German expressionist, Emil Nold, seascape. So it reflected something of that sense. And there is a baby also, but before that, in the middle, there is this passage leading into an inner room. That is where the painting gets its name from. And in that inner room, what you see are four corpses, dead people lying there. So this is obviously not a reflection of something real, but it's the idea that all homes may have some hidden aspects, some hidden nightmares, whatever it could be, inside their rooms, inside their, in different rooms. And actually, there are homes where people lock up certain rooms because they feel that there's some evil there, there's something that one shouldn't enter. So there's some secret about it. So that kind of thing. So this is the inner room. And then this is the baby who's, again, like death and birth, you know, life would go on kind of thing. There's an aspect I would like to point out to of the, I'll go back a little bit to the roof, the way in which the roof of the is painted. So here you see, it's more like as if there were waves in a sea or clouds. So the roof has become, it's like moving. So it adds in a sense to the kind of sense of doom that lies over this painting. It's called inner room. Yeah. And as I said, the baby, the death and the baby and life goes on. So we are back to a more straightforward painting. Structurally very complex. Coloristically also very complex in the sense that all the colors are extremely muted. There are many colors, but all of them are extremely muted. So there is a sense of calm that this painting has. It's called Another Day in the Old City, 2017. It's a large work. So I call it Another Day because it has that sense of, yeah, it's going to go on this way. One more day, another, someone will die, someone will be born, another day will come, another day will come. So it'll just go on and on like this. So that sense, which at times grips us, you know, at times we feel very agitated. We want to change things. We want to, you know, bring in the revolution. We want to do various things. At other times, we are completely kind of depressed and say, my God, nothing is right. You want to commit suicide, various things. And then you say, it's just another day. You know, it's just going to go on like this. So details of that painting, I said it's extremely complex structurally because the painting is actually evolved out of my experience of living in Pune before coming to Bombay. And then I keep returning to Pune, of course. And Pune being a city next to the river, there are many roads that actually, in the old city, there are many roads which go downwards to the river, like the one in this detail, on the right side, you see a road going down, steps going down to the river. And then there are roads that go upwards, which are going towards bridges that cross the river. So there are corners, street corners in the city where one road is going up, one road is going down. So many places like that. So it creates a very interesting perspective. And I wasn't very interested in that perspective aspect. And then it also creates extremely complex kind of structures of buildings also, old and new, coming up. So this is I was more interested in evolving a way in which to structure this complex kind of structures, buildings coming together. And of course, life going on here on the street, you see people going, coming, people waiting to open the shop. this person going towards the river. A dog taking its nap. Small pawn shop or something. This old man sipping his tea there. To the left, a boy sitting at the balcony with his legs out. This kind of observation of a woman above him that's who's sweeping the balcony. This kind of observation of everyday life, as I said in the first painting, everyday life has a certain kind of soothing effect on one's nerves. That you just see that these people are at the routine things that they do. And it's necessary for them to do that. And they do it happily or they do it unhappily, whatever. But they do it as part of what living is. So that is the kind of routine that people follow. Woman at a window. It's the quality of the surface and the quality of the color, quality of the paint that I was most interested in. To be able to achieve that faded effect, but rich in texture, in age, like something that has aged very gradually and over a period. Some more of those buildings on the right lower corner, someone sitting and reading the morning paper in his balcony. Various things, all these things that add up to another day in the old city. So this is the kind of, it's a recent painting, as I said, a couple of years back. And it led to also many other drawings and things like that within, which fed into that work. I will end now with one last painting, which is quite different in the sense it's a simple painting. Just after taking you through all this inside and outside and complexities of artist's life and complexities of city life, all that. Just a simple affirmative painting of a boy playing the flute. It's called Music Lessons, new painting done during the... It's actually from a sketch of our son who plays the flute and the keyboard and all that. So that is it. Thank you. I'll close the sharing.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for showing.
Thank you, Sujit.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. I think we can take a few questions, no, sir?
Yes.
There is only already one. Sina P, do you want to ask or shall I read it out?
I can ask. Hello, Dr. Patwardhan.
Yes.
I'm from KM Hospital. I studied in KM. I think you're from JJ, aren't you?
Hello.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, you studied in JJ, did you?
No. I studied in AFMC in Pune.
Okay. I'm from KM, Mumbai.
Okay.
Yeah, I paint a little bit, but not as spectacular as you have done. Just a few questions for you. I was impressed with your work. Amazing, amazing work. Just a few questions. Why did you move from oils to acrylics and back to oils? Do you work as a radiologist or are you a full-time artist? How long did the 7-panel painting take you to do? And I know your inspiration is Diego Rivera. You mentioned that and his big murals and industrial cityscapes. So I won't ask you who your inspiration is. And I wanted to check out with you whether you work from photographs.
Yeah. Well, oil and acrylic. I was painting in oil till 1990. One used to have problems with Bombay weather with fungus and things like that. So I thought I would give it acrylics a try, and I liked it, and I got into it within a year or so. I started using acrylics, and I've been using that for a long time. I still will continue with acrylics. It's very versatile. I use it somewhat like oil. So my acrylic paintings look almost as if they could have been done by oil. But there is something about oil that one does miss, you know, the way in which you can mix color on the canvas, the way in which it will respond to the brush mark and all that. So again, I've started using oils again, but not exclusively. I use both the mediums. So that is about the oil and acrylic. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Your second question was, sorry that I...
Yeah. How long did you take to do the seven panel painting?
That took me 2 years.
2 years. Do you work as a radiologist or are you a full-time painter?
Till 2005, I was working regularly. So 30 years from 75 to 2005, I worked as a radiologist. And then since 2005, I took retirement, early retirement, and now I'm a full-time painter.
And you paint daily?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
And do you work from photographs?
I do. Yes. I like to take a lot of photographs while I'm going about in the city. Mm. And many of the paintings are based on photographs. They're not based like a single photograph never becomes one painting. So there are multiple photographs that I might use to evolve the sketch for one painting. Mm. And then there are lots of distortions that I will do to the photograph and things like that.
Yeah. I will allow other people to ask questions. And if there's time, I've got one more question for you, sir.
Thanks, Sina. She's a practicing doctor in UK. So there's a question from Prajakta, another Mumbaiker. She's asking, may I know the year of the last work you showed?
What did she say?
She's asking the last work. I have the thank you slide, the year in which it was done.
Yes, this, it's done about 2 or 3 months back. The boy, no? Yes. Very recent. Yes.
Another question from Ashish Motwani. Do you want to ask or should I ask? Ashish Motwani? It's a long question.
You ask it. So this year.
Okay, fine. Okay. So it's asking, as you are not having the art background and you have not studied art, so how do you manage the figure drawings in your paintings? Have you faced the issue that you are not able to do academic drawing while you were painting?
Well, this question of being a self-taught artist, I think, is very relative. In the sense that what you learn in art school, you could learn on your own also. I had good teachers in the sense that I used, in Pune, when I started to paint, I used to go to an artist, show my work, take advice from him. Then, of course, as I mentioned, Shankar Palchikar was there in Thane, whom I used to meet often. He used to give me advice. So there were people who were advising me. I used to take their advice. And then one just evolves according to, you know, what one needs. I went to JJ for evening classes to learn modeling. I went to Shantiniketan to do something. So I went in different ways, maybe not like 5 years at a time in one school. But I don't quite agree with the thing of being self-taught. Like one teaches, even in school, ultimately you have to teach yourself a lot. You know, how many times you go to the library, how many teachers you go and ask questions to, how many, all that. So you might be 5 years in art school without doing much. So in that sense, I made good use of whatever I could.
So your early works are more like very straight and forward, you know, like there is no, in terms of visual I'm talking about.
Yes.
There is no multiple, perspective or something. It's more like a direct, and somewhere you're breaking that also in early works, like with color and all.
Yes.
And especially the Ullas Nagar and all the lake sort of a thing have different color and all.
Yes.
But when it comes to the recent works, you are more into, playing with the kind of a puzzle, you know, with the images.
Yes.
So why you are taking that turn as a visual, because of I know it's more complex, and also it is in a way, it is one can use as a easy way also, because it's a multiple thing in a single plane, and you're just putting it and then looking at, you know, as a puzzle. Mm-hmm. But which what actually made you to think in terms of that, you know, like to take this turn?
Well, one thing is that I think I'm more and more drawn to the idea of how we restructure the world visually. You know, when you are mm-hmm. looking, even when I'm walking on a street and I'm looking yep. left and right and I'm going ahead yep. and maybe turning back and looking at what I have just passed. Now, all yep. these elements are somehow building an image of that street in my head.
Okay.
So all through, even in a room, even in a house, when I move from one room, mm-hmm. go into the passage and then move into another room. It is like cinema, for example. If you're carrying a handheld video camera and you are actually going mm-hmm. and then you sit down on the editing table and want to make sense, some sense yep. of this.
Yep.
So how yep. will you structure it? So in similar ways, I'm interested in how to structure our visual things because mm-hmm. our life seems to be complex in that sense. And I'm more yep. responsive to that complexity now. Earlier, one had more strong things to say directly.
Yeah.
When one is young, one goes and says whatever one comes first thing that comes to your mind. It's a very positive thing.
Yeah.
Later, maybe you somewhat lose that. You cannot go, you know, just make a statement. You want to think whether it is right or wrong. You want yep. you yep. want to yep. also add some element that may be either contrary or might complement that. So this kind of complexity enters. So that is, I think, one of the reasons why my movement towards more complex structures and things like that has happened.
Could I check out with you, sir, one more question?
Also the how much this influence from this mural painting tradition, you know, Mexican murals and all. You yes. already mentioned that. So
yes.
is that also...
it's a very important influence. You know, yeah. I mean, the main influences have been Diego Rivera, of course, and also Vinod yeah. Bihari Mukherjee's Hindi Bhavan mural in Shantiniketan
yeah.
has been a source yeah. of inspiration. You know, the kind of narrative that is there in mural painting, there is a certain kind of spatial narrative that you move from one image yep. to another, to another, to another, and build up that narrative. Ghulam does that very well. Ghulam Sheikh uses that way of using mural technique yep. to unfold a story. For me, there is a slightly different element. For example, I'll give you the Akbar Padam sees when he painted yeah, the gray period. In gray period of Akbar Padamsi, he painted many long horizontal works like the Juhu work, yep. like this Greek landscape, and there are a few others.
Mm-hmm.
Now, mm-hmm. in mural painting, mm-hmm. when you see, you move your eyes and read sequentially different parts of the painting.
Okay.
And then you build that whole, the meaning of the whole in your mind.
Okay.
But in Akbar's painting, they come both ways. You also see it sequentially, but you also see the whole in one glass, which is a typically modernist aesthetic. The modernist aesthetic is that you have to stand in front of the painting and the whole painting as a gestalt should enter you and you make. So I kind of somewhat want to bring together these two elements. That for me, for example, in the last painting, another day in the old city. It is like a complex way you can move around from one to another, but also as the whole painting, it must come through as a completed whole in one glance. So both these aspects are important for me in that sense. Okay. I don't know if it answers, but this is the way I can put it.
Yeah, I think. Thank you for that, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Could I check out with you, sir? Have you dabbled in any other media other than acrylics and oils?
Well, I do a lot of drawing with charcoal, pencil, whatever, oil stick, all that. So that is almost, there are many more drawings that I do than painting. So that is an important thing. I've done some terracotta. Yeah, and photography has remained for me an important like background. Like I'm continuously taking photographs. I've exhibited a few sometimes, but it's not what I want to work in as an artist, but they are important for me as from what I work. So these are the mediums, no other medium.
And when you said you use acrylic as oils, do you use a retardant for it to slow down the drying?
No, with acrylic I don't.
Just water.
But I do use a lot of medium, like gels and things like that, but not a retarder.
So a couple of questions from Shanti. So one, she has asked, as you trained as a doctor, then what made you to turn to painting? That is one. And second, she's asking, were your initial works also inspired by the city and city life?
Yes, I have been painting since my medical school. So it is not as if I turned from being a doctor to an artist, but one couldn't make a living as an artist. One still can't, I think. So being a doctor was very useful. And city has always been the main inspiration. Yes, right from the beginning.
Okay. So then Kumaraswamy, he has a few questions. So he's asking, recent works looks more like biographical. Is there any influence of your own? Maybe your own life, I think you have. The recent works look more biographical. Kumaraswamy, he was asking.
Yes.
So recent works are landscapes and look very biographical. And is there any influence from own life, I think?
Yes, very much so. As I said, from 2005, actually, there was a shift. Where I started to paint my own studio right now. Now, first I was painting the problems as an artist. What problems as an artist I'm facing, what questions. So I was making that into the subject matter of the work. But then your personal life also becomes part of the work. And then the way in which you read relationships, human relationships, all this, you start to realize that. And then, of course, we became grandparents. So that becomes a very important kind of experience of becoming a grandparent. You know, till then you are a father or you're a son, and now you are outside both being father and son, but you're a grandparent. So that introduces other complexities at the way in which you look at the progress of life, you know, how life moves on, new generations come in place, new generations have their own problems, they move on. So biographical, yes, very much so in the recent years, but I do return to, as I said, outside, to the city, because I keep returning to the city, to the problems outside our lives, that also.
Okay, so Ashish Motwani has a question to ask.
Yes.
Student, right?
Yes, good evening, sir. I am student of Alex Matthew, sir, and we used to hear so many stories about you from him. So I have one question that, sir, ever you have find that you don't, like, you have not studied in art school or you have not done that academic drawing. So have it become problem for you sometimes? Like you use so many, you are using so many figures in your painting. So have you ever found any problem during the drawing?
I don't think I have faced a problem on that aspect. I'll talk a little about the having not had academic training. Okay, I'll say that first. Not having gone to art school does leave some things that you wish you could do more easily. For example, printmaking. Printmaking is something that I didn't learn, and I tried to do a little bit afterwards, but it's something that I wish if I had a more kind of, you know, proper training in printmaking, I would have done more printmaking. So there are things like that. But about figure drawing, I did a lot of drawing from life. I used to go and right from the time I was in medical school, I used to go to the bus stand, I used to go to the railway station. I was continuously drawing human figures. So I don't think I had any problem in drawing the human figure. Apart from that, people ask me, being a doctor, your anatomy must be good and all. I don't really know how much difference it makes. because I know a lot of doctors whose drawing is very bad. So it's not necessary that, but for me, maybe it also helped. But more than that, there is a small incident that I heard someone, a small story. Madhav Satolekar was a painter, old painter. He was a contemporary of Vaishikar. You know, after studying here in JJ, he went to the UK and he to study. And he joined a live class and he was making drawings. And the teacher there, some famous person who saw his drawings, and he says, all your practice has been on the antique. You know? So that one sentence opened his eyes that he had never drawn from life. And even the model that is posed in an art college is like an antique, because she's not supposed to move. She's supposed to sit still, he or she. And you're supposed to draw the tones and the tonalities and the thing exactly as it is, as if it is an object. So for me, figure drawing was never a drawing of an object. It was a drawing of a living person, breathing person. So I think that made a difference. So I had no problem. I don't see that I had any problem about academic drawing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
There's a question from Smriti Rastogi. She's asking, have you ever questioned your style? What makes an artist not doubt his or her work? Not doubt. Mm-hmm. So question is have you ever questioned your style?
Yeah.
And then adding to that, what makes an artist not doubt his or her work?
Yeah. I think when an artist stops being an artist, he does not doubt himself. As long as you doubt yourself, you are still an artist. So doubt is part of being an artist. Now, about my style, I don't really think that I have one stylist. Basically, you can say realistic. Yeah, I'm like a realistic painter. That is fine. But my realism changes according to subject. So I have not attempted to, and I have not been able to also, let us say, evolve a particular style of painting. So I am not very attached to that of style as such.
So, do you still doubt yourself, like still?
Yeah. What exactly is on your mind? What do you doubt about what you are doing right now?
Actually, I'm still I'm a student. I'm still working. I'm also an artist, and I'm still working. And there are times when I really question myself that if I really, what I'm doing is right, or probably is it developing or not, and whatever I want to show, is it getting portrayed or not well. And I really doubt myself because I'm still pursuing my field, and there are a lot of doubts and a lot of questions which occur. And also you mentioned before that there's no livelihood, you cannot earn that much, and so all that really intrigues me and makes me worried sometimes, and also
yeah
all that. So
that's true. I mean, this element of doubt, I think you should learn to live with. As an artist, you will always be questioning yourself, just as you're questioning everything around you. So
yeah.
It will be part of you. It's difficult. So many times it can lead to kind of depression and all that, but just continuing to work, continuing to get pleasure out of work. One thing that if you stop liking to work, if you feel that work is boring, then there is a problem. As long as you want to get down to work, things will move. You know? And then this question of livelihood as an artist will always remain a question. You know, it was never in India or anywhere else, it's very difficult really to make a living out of what you want to do. You know,
yeah.
There will be demands on you. Even when you become quite famous, there will be demands from galleries and all that. They want that kind of painting. They want this kind of work. So there will always be those pressures. So you have to face up to it, continue to do what you want to do. And to do that, usually my advice to students is that make sure that you have some other source of livelihood. If you want to continue, this is a like a long-term thing, you know. Next years, making your name, getting a gallery, all that is dicey, you know. So you have to say that next 20 years, I have to continue to paint or draw or whatever I'm doing. And to do that, I have to invest, to say, 4 hours or whatever hours into something else. That is my personal advice. Maybe it comes because I did that myself. I had a regular job as a doctor and I did that. So it comes more easily to me. Many young artists feel uncomfortable. They feel like full-time painter hi banna hai.
Yeah.
There are risks in that.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, there are some questions from Facebook Live, some people who have asked there. So can I read
them? Yeah, please.
Okay. So one is from Geetesh Shinde. It's asking, have you painted the experiences of medical field?
There are a few paintings of my clinic. They are not really of the medical field in the sense of going into medicine as such. But they're of people, they're of patients. So patients used to be a source for me, just as if I'm looking at someone in the market as a person, he is a source. So similarly, the patients. And patients used to be a special source because patients come to you with a certain mindset. They come to you for advice, they come to you for help, whatever. So your relationship with patients is more intimate. So they, for many of my paintings, have been subjects, or you know, they have been inspiration, but I have not painted a medical subject as such, other than people sitting in a clinic or things like that.
Thank you.
Can I
will just take this Facebook couple, then I'll come to Buddha. Okay, Buddha? Okay. Yeah, because people in Facebook, they should also feel like we are considering their questions, right?
Okay. Please.
Sorry. Yeah. So from Shashi Kumar Kathirur, he's asking, previously your paintings were live with workers and metro morgue, but now you are more fond of streets and buildings. Life seems concealed inside. Why this change? Is this an influence of photographs? Sir, should I repeat?
I get the sense. That is true that earlier I was painting the working class, more figures from the working class. And there was an ideological kind of commitment to doing that in the early phases, where I considered myself Marxist and I considered myself to be a spokesman for the working class. So I was painting their images on their behalf almost. That was my sense. And therefore, there was a committed attempt to paint the working class. Later, it became more general that I was painting what I saw around me. There were people from the middle class, people from the working class. And then the working class itself became ill-defined in the sense that organized working class stopped to exist after the 90s in a sense, you know. And then you have all this kind of contract labor, and there is no movement. There is no trade union movement, things like that, that can hold this together. So everything has changed post-90s. So then my interest has become to paint ordinary people who seem to be at the receiving end in some sense. That is one commitment, that people at the receiving end of life, I'm drawn more to painting them. About painting buildings and things, it is true that there was after a certain period, after painting street life at street level, I started to move back and paint the city as a panorama. You know, going outside and painting the city as an image. So this gave me opportunities to paint buildings, to paint things from far. So more of that element of the structural element started entering more. So they became more complex paintings in that sense compared to the earlier ones. For example, early painting of the train, for example, just 2-3 people standing in front of a train compartment or a man drinking tea. So these were very close-up paintings. Then I moved to paintings that are more inclusive in that sense. So there is a movement away from, and there is an influence of photography. I started to use more photographs only after mid-80s or so, 90s. Before that, I was not doing any. One didn't have the convenience of, you know, carrying a... Now one can carry a mobile, right, in this, you know, without being noticed by anyone, one goes on clicking. So it's, I use that more.
Thank you, sir. So one question from Vandana Kothari, again from... not here, from Facebook. So he's asking, why did you choose realism as a mode of representation in contrast with most of the Indian modernist artists who are diverging away from realism?
Well, I do not know who you have in mind, but I see a strong realistic element in a lot of contemporary work in various ways, you know. Realistic in the sense that a relationship with reality is being established. You know, it might be in various ways, but in the work of a lot of people, I see that this attempt is done. And in Kerala, of course, there are a lot of painters who are painting reality in many ways. So realism is still definitely around quite a bit, but there are other modalities also. And it's just my personal, preference. It's the way in which I think, is the way in which I want to understand the world. People want to understand the world more symbolically sometimes. People want to understand the world through abstraction, through colors and lines and things like that. I want to understand through what I see before me in that sense. And therefore, I'm more attracted to painting in this particular way.
Thank you, sir. Buddha, over to you.
Thank you, Satish. Thank you, sir. It's a great pleasure to, you know, see your work and know your words. I just wanted to know, like, you were in the middle, like, before the digital world and after the digital world. So how you think the change is, like, and how it's impacting your work? First question. And second is, like, now who are doing work, practicing artists, they have a lot of opportunities and also some distractions. So what is your advice, like, as an experienced mentor or as an experienced artist, what is your advice to the younger artists who are practicing? Thank you, sir.
Digital, in the sense, do you mean like the digital media and things like that, or just the use of digital photography and things like that? Because digital photography has been around for some time, and I have been using that, and I've been using Photoshop and all that. That element is already there. Digital media, like, you know, the new media as such, I looked at them, I tried a few things, but I was not kind of drawn to it in any sense. But I love the work of many artists who are actually using that. So many artists who, for Jitish Kalat, for example, uses many things that are quite contemporary. Shilpa Gupta uses a lot. So there are many artists, and then there are ways in which other people have moved in other directions also, towards more interactive work, towards more social involvement, various things. So what exactly would you mean, like, they confront difficulties? It's difficult for me to say advice. Each generation faces its own kind of difficulties. They have to face up with various kinds of things. Each time there are opportunities also. For example, Nalini has used digital media and things like that very effectively, and she quite loves doing that. So Nalini Manani. So there are older artists also who are using that. But I really don't know. It's difficult for me to say. For example, I cannot say that a painting which is concrete object gives an experience which is more grounded than seeing an image only. Now, if that image is made only for being on the net, then it has its own validity. Only if it is an image of a painting, then I would prefer to see the painting in life. But if it is that, if that image is a something that has been made for the net, then one has to assess it in that capacity. So I don't know exactly where my answer is going and whether it is coming anywhere close to what you have in mind. Maybe you can add to your question somewhat.
Thank you. Actually, the artists like who are doing work with traditional mediums also, and now the artists who are adopting the new media. But for my opinion, like the sensibility and the time, that is more important than the medium. What do you think about that? Just curious to know.
I tend to agree with you there that the amount of time that an artist spends in doing in the process of that medium itself will be very important. And the way in which he learns the language of that medium is very important. For example, a simple example is between filmmaking and video art. You know, when video art came up, it was so simple to do videos and show them as artworks. But many of these people were quite illiterate about the whole tradition of filmmaking. And they being so close, it showed in their work that it was immaturish. It did not have the same kind of complexity of being something that unfolds in time, you know, which a filmmaker is more conscious of. So that kind of giving that medium, that kind of time is very important, but it's very difficult. Like today, where everything is changing within 5 years, I do not know really. I used to face this problem even as a radiologist, for example, you know, like an earlier generation of radiologists were seeing one particular form of the medium, like actual X-rays or plates. And then within a short period, they moved from like digital X-rays to CT to MRI to other modalities. And you had like specialists who had 2 years or 1 year or sometimes 6 months experience doing some modality. And they were reporting on these. I would feel that, you know, there's something going wrong here in the rate at which things change and the rate at which people come to get used to it, to understand that properly. But I may be wrong, I don't know.
Thank you, sir. One more question from Prajakta. She's asking, in your last solo with Vadera, the preview done at Jahangir, one could feel a silence in the space created by you. Silence. If it is so, can you please talk about it?
Better not to say anything about silence.
Be silent, right?
In a sense, I think it refers to there are many things that can be said between things, between what you are saying. Like all authors, for example, know. Any good author or poet or novelist will know that what he says between the lines is as important as what he says in the lines, right? So similarly, it is with painting, that what you, or with any art, that what you leave out saying, which you are implying in a sense. So this silence somewhere is towards that element, that you're showing one thing, but there are other things that are, they are evoked. They are more evoked rather than said, you know. So that probably, but I have always valued silence of that kind, you know. So there are many instances. I mean, for example, the best of Gayatonde I think they evoke a kind of silence that is quite rare, you know. So it's a very important experience. Similarly, you feel even in Tayyab Mehta, whose subject is so different, and the woman in the image is screaming, you know, the images of someone screaming, and yet there is an element of silence in that image, the way in which the color harmonies and the way in which the planes are juxtaposed. So an artist, I think, is always seeking somewhere that kind of a space.
Thank you, sir. Two more questions with that we'll wind up. One is Kaval Mirchandani asks, has the pandemic affected your work? Did see some works you did on the human migration? If you could share your views on the same.
Hello, Kaval. Nice to have you here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. The work that you're referring to, I did few small works initially when I was looking at television images of migrant workers returning and leaving the city. So it was extremely moving, and it was extremely disturbing, you know, the way in which the city had turned its back on them in that sense. And then this image of a larger work where the city has become distant, you know, just as, for example, in the work Nagrik, if you were here, you would have seen that work, where there is a sense of not belonging, you know. So similarly, for these people, for these migrant workers, the city has become distant. They need it. Livelihood is in the city. They need to come back. And yet, the way in which they had to go away, the way in which they had to leave it, they have been made to feel their that they're dispensable in that sense. So that is the sense of that work, where there are people moving away, but also looking back, you know, and in all, in the heat, in the rain, in every kind of situation, that the city will always be attract workers. City will always be the main employer in that sense, but it will always also be the opposite of that. It will always be the most harsh place to live in. So that is the sense of those works on migrants.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I'll club two questions. Both are, I think, related to the artists you admire. So one question is, like Pavan Maurya is asking, there are so many questions about your art training. If you get a chance to get trained from an artist from the past, who would that be? And there was another question from Sina. She was also asking, who are the contemporary Indian artists whom you admire? So these two things I'll club.
Artists from the past. Velasquez, I think. I'd love to train under Velasquez. Yeah, just a dream, like, yeah. But present day, there are so many artists that I admire. I mean, I've always mentioned Akbar and Tayyab as major influences. And their influence was much beyond the paintings as such. Their influence was also to do with the life of an artist, what that commitment means in difficult situations, you know. So for both, it was difficult. It may not be financially for Akbar, but still, like, in terms of acceptance, in terms of living a life of an artist, is never easy. So Akbar and Tayyab have always been. Giv has been a close friend, Giv Patel, and has always been an advisor, and I've looked up to him. Bhupen was someone I admired as a painter greatly. And as a painter, I mentioned, because more than, the subject matter and his the homoerotic works and things like that are, of course, very bold and very path-breaking. But simple things in which he used to paint, I think, are still evoke a lot of feeling and a lot of care about what you, the way in which you see and paint something. So, and then among younger artists, again, there are many younger artists that I've admired. You saw Reggie's work in my house. Jyoti Basu is fantastic, I think. Alex, you mentioned Alex, been close friends, and I've always admired the way in which he has worked. So there are lots of things, lots of young people. Jitish and Atul, of course. Atul is someone who no one can not admire because, for one thing, the amount of work that he can produce and the good quality, high quality work. It's amazing. I mean, I don't think there's anyone in. I mean, Hussein also probably did not produce as much as Atul does. So it's great. And then he has so much more variety, so much more. So lots of things. Anju's intensity, lot of things. I've loved some of Sujit's work, some lovely night landscape. Oh. I take inspiration from a lot of people, a lot of younger people also. I take a lot of inspiration from them.
Thank you, sir.
And
one last question with this, I think, Vilan, it was about your last painting on the presentation. So that was Shanti is asking, you painted your son in the childhood playing the flute, and that is as opposed to the complexities of your other works. This is very sweet and simple. What is the story behind that?
There's no story as such. I had a sketch which I had done at that time when he was maybe 8 or 10 years old. And the sketch was with me. During this period of lockdown, something prompted me to kind of go back and pick it up and work on it. And it, in a sense, like the simplicity and things like that, you want to reaffirm.
Okay. Yeah, there are so many other questions many people have and ask, but we can't take everything. And, you know, sir has spent so much of time with us.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir. And thanks to Sujit for, you know, bringing Sudhir sir to this show. And thank you for all the people who are watching this show in the Facebook also, and also here and participated actively. And Sudhir sir, a big, big thank you. And you have given us so much of energy in this new year to go ahead. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for...
thank you, Satish.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all. So, great wish, a great 2021 to everyone. We wind up the show. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
All of you.